Welcome to Bethel Baptist Church this morning. Let's open our service by standing and let's sing "At the Cross Where I First Saw the Light." Let's sing it together.
Alas, and did my Savior bleed, and did my Sovereign die? Would He devote that sacred head for sinners such as I? At the cross where I first saw the light, and the burden of my heart rolled away. It was there by faith I received my sight, and now I am happy all the day.
Good morning, church. What a joy it is to see you all out here on this beautiful sunshiny day. I heard yesterday somebody say that this January is the wettest January on record, and I'm not going to doubt it. But you know what? I am so thankful that you are here in God's house today, and we're also very thankful for those of you that have joined us on Facebook. And on those on Facebook, please say something. Let us know that you are watching or that you have watched this worship service, and we're delighted that you have tuned in with us. And if we can ever minister to you in any kind of way, you please let us know. And to all of our home folk, thank you for being here. And to our guest, on your bulletin that you received whenever you came in, there's a QR code that says, "Let's Connect." And if you would, take a moment and click on that, fill that out, or talk to me as you're going out the front door. We would love to connect with you and get to know you, and for you to also get to know us. But as we have gathered here in the Lord's house on this beautiful Lord's Day He's given to us, let us count our many blessings and name them one by one. And this morning we're going to do something just a little bit different. And that is, truly, we need to count our blessings. So somebody just tell me just real quick, just something you're thankful for, just one thing. What are you thankful for? Church family. What else? Health. What else? You was able to get up this morning. Amen. What else? Jesus. Life. What else you thankful for? Family. What else?
Sunshine.
Yes, glorious sunshine. See, the Lord has blessed us. Only thing we got to do is take a moment and realize it and give Him thanks. And let's look at our call to worship verse of Scripture this morning. And we ask if you would to read that aloud with me. He says, "Be still and know that I am God. I will be exalted among the nations. I will be exalted in the earth." And may I add, may He be exalted right here at Bethel Baptist Church. Brother Michael Martin, if you'll come and have our invocation.
Let us pray. Thank you, Heavenly Father, for this beautiful day that you've given us in this great, wonderful country. We ask you that you might watch over these leaders of this country, that they may have godly counsel, that they may be able to do your will and not the will of man. Watch over all of us as we go on our daily travel. Watch over Daniel as he gives us lessons. Open our ears and open our hearts that we may understand what your word is and what you desire for us to be. May everything we do be the glory to you. In your name's sake, amen.
Amen. Let's continue in our singing by singing "The Power of the Cross."
To see the dawn of the darkest day, Christ on the road to Calvary, tried by sinful men, torn and beaten then, nailed to a cross of wood. Is the power of the cross, Christ became The mystery of the cross I cannot comprehend, the agonies of Calvary. You, the perfect Holy One, sent to die, drank the bitter cup reserved for me. Your blood perfect sacrifice I've been brought near. Your enemy you've made your friend, pouring out the riches of your glorious grace, your mercy and your kindness know no end. Your blood. Please satisfy.
Y'all can dismiss now to Children's Church. Y'all come on out. The songs in which we just sung certainly ministered to my heart and to my soul, and I pray that they did to you as well. You know, and today we're going to be faced on about making decisions. And, you know, I'm going to preach about this, but I just want to just give you something to be praying about right now. And that is that, you know, our decisions are never just our own. They're based on something. You know, and one of the things that we want to do is we want to have wisdom to be able to make good decisions. You know, and some people equate wisdom with knowledge, and they equate knowledge with degrees. But I want to share something with you today, and that is that wisdom and knowledge is not the same thing. You see, the world can teach you in books and can send you to schools and can give you degrees, and you can be very smart intellectually, but be as dumb as a rock when it comes down to wisdom. For see, some of the wisest people that I have ever known in my life would, on the worldly counts, be some of perhaps the most ignorant people I've ever known. Maybe illiterate, or maybe learning disabilities, whatever it may be. But they were wise. The Bible is very plain in teaching us one thing, and that is if we lack wisdom, we should ask for it. And he says that whenever we ask for it, God will give it to us abundantly. And so today, I ask you to pray that your decisions would be made wisely. You know, there's an old thing that has been around for a long time, WWJD. What would Jesus do? Well, folks, you won't know what would Jesus do until you know what Jesus did. And that's the importance of church. That's the importance of being in the Bible. That's the importance of praying and talking to Him. So we do want to be wise, but not in our own eyes, but in the eyes of God. So perhaps if you've never cried out to God, God, please give me wisdom. Please understand, it's not that the heavens are going to open up and all of a sudden you're going to walk out of here being smart, but you may walk out of here knowing the presence of God with you through the moving of the Holy Spirit. That would help you to make those decisions. And then there's also this. When you pray for wisdom, it's kind of like praying for patience. You know, they tell you, don't pray for patience because then God will put something on you that'll make you develop patience. Well, that's just an old wives' tale. But you know, whenever you pray for wisdom, don't be surprised if God does not give you difficult situations to be able to grow in Him. That will help make you wise. Because a lot of our wisdom comes from experiences. And those experiences is, where were we with God and where was God with us when we made those decisions? Will you cry out to Him today in this time of prayer, just saying, Lord, please help me to be wise. Let's pray. Our Father God, we come to you this morning, Lord, first off, praising you, God, for who you are, and God, for who you have allowed us to be in you, your children. And God, we know that you desire to bless us as your children. And God, it is very human for us to want to see the blessings, Father, in things in which we might be able to hold in our hands, or places we could go, or people we could know. But God, we know that the real blessing, Lord, is whenever we know your presence, Lord, with us through the moving of your Holy Spirit. And God, in life, we have to make decisions. And God, we want to be guided by your Holy Spirit. God, we do want to be wise. Lord, your scripture has taught us that, Lord, that if we lack wisdom, we're to ask for it. So God, we come to you once again this day, Father, asking for wisdom. We know, Father, that it is more valuable than any money or gold or land or properties, Lord, in which we could ever possess, Lord, is to have wisdom. And Lord, no greater wisdom than that to ask ourselves, truly, Lord, make us like your Son, Jesus. Lord, we know, Father, that from his example, he always made the wise decision. Lord, we thank you, Father, for his example that he set before us. And now we pray, Father, that you would teach us. God, thank you, Lord, for giving us this opportunity to be in your house one more time. Father, to be under the inspiration, Lord, of the music that is being played and the songs that are being sung and the prayers that are being prayed and the offerings that are being given. And Father, the fellowship, Lord, that will be shared, but Lord, also and especially the preaching and teaching of your precious word. So Father, reveal yourself to us this day in ways that, Lord, that we might grow closer to you and be much wiser than what we were whenever we came into this place. Help us, God, to see ourselves in you and know you in personal and real ways. And it's in Jesus' name I pray. Amen.
Update you on a real intense meeting between the personnel committee and the and the stewardship committee had last week.
Oh boy. You fire me or cutting my pay or both? Was that Ron Hunt that said that? I expect nothing less.
I had a big long speech. This meeting we had was very intense. It went back and forth between personnel and stewardship. Wouldn't give us no money to hire personnel. So, you know, we said, well, maybe we just stick with what we got.
Couldn't do no better, huh?
Listen, brother.
Yes, sir.
We appreciate you.
I appreciate y'all.
Personnel wouldn't let me hire a maintenance man or a plumber or anything like that. Let's just keep the preacher. You know, he's good. He does all that.
Keep him in a truck and a toolbox.
Yeah. So I want to say thank you for being my pastor, for being my brother, for being my friend.
Thank you, brother.
And we did get a little something. I'm going to give you that right there for your 18th anniversary.
Wow.
And it's got in there, I promise to do 18 more.
Oh, boy. Well, this was totally unexpected, honestly. You know, y'all blessed me in so many ways at so many different times, and it's hard to believe it's been 18 years since I stepped in this pulpit for the very first time to be your pastor. And what a joy, I'd have to say, that it is. And the old thing says, remember the best and forget the rest. And that's what we want to do. And I still believe that the better days are still yet to come. But thank you so much for your love, your support, your prayers, and for keeping me around. And hopefully we'll see another 18 years or more. Thank y'all.
Amen. Let's stand one more time and let's sing, "Are You Washed in the Blood of the Lamb?"
Have you been to Jesus for the cleansing power? Are you washed in the blood of the Lamb? Are you fully trusting in His grace this hour? Are you washed in the blood of the Lamb? Are you washed in the blood, in the soul? If you could see what I once was, if you could go with me back to where I started from, then I know you would see a miracle of love that took me in its sweet embrace and made me what I am today, an old sinner saved by grace. I'm just a sinner saved by grace. When I stood condemned to death,
He took my place. Now I live and breathe in freedom. With each breath of life I take, I'm loved and forgiven. Back with the living, I'm just a sinner saved by grace. Boast of anything I've ever seen or done. How could I dare to claim as mine the victories God has won? Where could I be had God not brought me safely to this place? I'm here to say I'm nothing but just an old sinner saved by grace. I'm just a sinner saved by grace. When I stood condemned to death, He took my place. Now I grow and breathe in freedom. With each breath of life I take, loved and forgiven. Back with the I'm just a sinner saved by grace. Now I grow and breathe in freedom. With each breath of life I take, I'm loved and forgiven. Back with the living, I'm just a sinner saved by grace, saved by grace.
Thank you, brother. To be sick, you sure did do good. As we continue with these series of sermons on leading to the cross, next week I will actually begin the series on the seven last sayings of Christ while he was on the cross. For our Lord and Savior delivered seven messages. Some of those were a word, some of them were a sentence. But in order to really grasp what was happening at that moment, at that time, we have to go back to before the cross. And we see some of the agony that Jesus lived through long before there was ever nails in his hands and his feet, or even as we are leading up to even a sword in his side. There was
the trial. The trial that Jesus had to endure. That whenever he was in the garden, as we have seen last week, whenever he was praying and he was asking his Father to let this cup pass from him, but he plainly stated, "But nevertheless, thy will be done." And whenever we heard those words, and then we were able to see what happened next, and that was that Judas showed up with the guards and gave that betrayal kiss upon the cheek of Jesus and pointed him out, and they took my Lord, our Savior, away in chains. And today we're going to examine his time before Pilate and understanding the decisions that must be made. You see, each and every one of us have decisions in which we must make in our lives. Some of those decisions are big, some of them are small. But every day of your life, you make a decision. You're forced to make decisions about everything that you do. For you see, the blessing of living in a free country is that we're able to move about and do pretty much as what we will within the parameters of the law. There was nobody this morning forcing you to get up as if you were in prison somewhere. There was nobody there forcing you in a march to have to come to this particular place called a church. But instead, you got up under the unction of the Holy Spirit and under the decision that you wanted to be with God's people in God's house to learn more about God. And so you came. And so thank you for making that decision. And right now, the most important decision is not what are we going to have for lunch. The most important decision right now is, will I pay attention not to what the preacher has to say, but what the Holy Spirit will reveal to me this day. What the Holy Spirit is going to show me from God's Word to be able to teach me about being a wise person for God. And so in a moment, we will read these scriptures and we're going to search out about those who had decisions to make. Pilate had a decision. Jesus had a decision. The people had a decision. His disciples had decisions. The guards even had decisions. All that they had to make. What decision will you make? Let's pray. Father God, as we open up your word, we come to you once again thanking you for your precious word that teaches us. Teaches us about you. And God, we see your great love for us through your Son, Jesus Christ, who knew no sin but yet suffered for our sins, who went through the agony of the betrayal, the arrest, this trial, and Father, through the beating and then the cross. And oh God, we thank you that he did. Because if he wouldn't, we wouldn't be here today. And so God, move us closer to you as we desire, Father, to move closer to you as we humbly find ourselves at the foot of the cross. And so God, you move during this time in such a way that, Lord, that it will draw all of us closer to you. And it's in Jesus' name I pray. Amen. This morning I will be reading from Matthew chapter 27, and on the screen will be verses 11 through 26, but I will continue on in the Bible reading through the end of verse 31, and then we're going to turn over to John chapter 19 and read the first 16 verses. Now Jesus was standing before Pilate, and this was after his arrest whenever he was taken out of the garden. The Roman governor. "Are you the king of the Jews?" the governor asked him. And Jesus replied, "You have said it." But when the leading priests and the elders made their accusations against him, Jesus remained silent. "Don't you hear these charges they are bringing against you?" Pilate demanded. But Jesus made no response to any of the charges, much to the governor's surprise. Now, it was the governor's custom each year during the Passover celebration to release one prisoner to the crowd, anyone they wanted. This year, there was a notorious prisoner, a man named Barabbas. As the crowd gathered before Pilate's house that morning, he asked them, "Which one do you want me to release to you, Barabbas or Jesus, who is called the Messiah?" He knew very well that the religious leaders had arrested Jesus out of envy. Just then, as Pilate was sitting on the judgment seat, his wife sent him this message, "Leave that innocent man alone. I have suffered through a terrible nightmare about him last night." Meanwhile, the leading priest and the elders persuaded the crowd to ask for Barabbas to be released and for Jesus to be put to death. So the governor asked again, "Which of these two do you want me to release to you?" And the crowd shouted back, "Barabbas! Barabbas! Barabbas!" Pilate responded, "What should I do with Jesus, who is called the Messiah?" And they shouted back, "Crucify him! Crucify him! Crucify him!" "Why?" Pilate demanded. "What crime has he done?" But the mob roared even louder, "Crucify him." Pilate saw that he wasn't getting anywhere and that a riot was developing, so he sent for a bowl of water and he washed his hands before the crowd, saying, "I am innocent of this man's blood. The responsibility is yours." And all the people yelled back, "We will take responsibility for his death, we and our children." And in some translations it says, "Let his blood be on us and on our children." So Pilate released Barabbas to them, and he ordered Jesus flogged with a lead-tipped whip, then turned him over to the Roman soldiers to be crucified. Some of the governor's soldiers took Jesus into their headquarters and called out the entire regiment. They stripped him and put a scarlet robe on him. They wove thorn branches into a crown and put it on his head, and they placed a reed stick in his right hand as a scepter. Then they knelt before him in mockery and taunted, "Hail, King of the Jews!" And they spit on him and grabbed the stick and struck him on the head with it. When they were finally tired of mocking him, they took off the robe and put his own clothes on him again. Then they led him away to be crucified. And from the book of John, the 19th chapter, we read, "Then Pilate had Jesus flogged with a lead-tipped whip. And the soldiers wove a crown of thorns and put it on his head, and they put a purple robe on him. And hail the King of the Jews," they mocked as they slapped him across the face. Pilate went outside again and said to the people, "I'm going to bring him out to you now, but understand clearly that I find him not guilty." Then Jesus came out wearing the crown of thorns and the purple robe, and Pilate said, "Look, here is the man." And when they saw him, the leading priest and temple guards began shouting, "Crucify him! Crucify him! Crucify him! Take him yourself and crucify him," Pilate said. "I find him not guilty." The Jewish leaders replied, "By our law, he ought to die because he called himself the Son of God." When Pilate heard this, he was more frightened than ever. He took Jesus back into the headquarters again and asked him, "Where are you from?" But Jesus gave no answer. "Why don't you talk to me?" Pilate demanded. "Don't you realize that I have the power to release you or crucify you?" Then Jesus said, "You would have no power over me at all unless it were given to you from above. So the one who handed me over to you has the greater sin." But Jesus gave no answer. And he says, and then Pilate tried to release him. But the Jewish leaders shouted, "If you release this man, you are no friend of Caesar. Anyone who declares himself a king is a rebel against Caesar." When they said this, Pilate brought Jesus out to them again. Then Pilate sat down on the judgment seat of the platform that is called the stone pavement, in Hebrew, Gabbatha. It was now about noon on the day of preparation for the Passover. And Pilate said to the people, "Look here! Here's your king." "Away with him," they yelled. "Away with him and crucify him." "What? Crucify your king?" Pilate asked. "We have no king but Caesar," the leading priest shouted back. And Pilate turned Jesus over to them to be crucified. Father God, as we find ourselves once again in your word, God, we find ourselves listening in on what took place. But God, may we be reminded that, Father, that while we were not there physically, our sins were. Our desires, our thoughts, our actions were right there. And God, as you take us back to this place, God, help us to see who we are, sinners, no better. For God, truly, probably out of our own mouths, we would have been the very ones calling out, crucifying. But God, help us now to make wiser decisions. Thank you, God, that we once were sinners, but now we've been saved by grace. And God, may we live in that grace daily, turning away from sin and living for your Son, Jesus. And it's in his name I pray. Amen. Decisions. Every single day of your life, you have to make decisions. We've already explored some of the decisions in which you had to make today. You know, and from those decisions, there are some that are not going to have very long-lasting repercussions. Some are going to last to where you make a decision on something, and in a moment, you may have even forgot what your decision was. It just came naturally. Other decisions, you have spent a lot of time in prayer, and perhaps if you were not in prayer, you were agonizing over it in your own self-worry and your own anxiety, trying to make a decision based upon your own wisdom. I would tell you today that some of the more important decisions that you may make in your life, I guarantee you, will affect not only you, but everyone that is around you. I will give you some examples of this and some illustrations just to help you to understand. And that is that in our life, if you make the decision that you're going to run that red light and speed right through it, and there's other traffic coming, you're going to impact probably somebody else's car, but their life as well, because you made a dumb decision. You broke the law. And you know, and while your car may receive some damage and you may walk away from it, you may total somebody else's car and you may kill that person. So let us be wise in our decisions. And God has given us the laws to be able to stay within sight of, to be able to help keep us safe. Other decisions in which we may make, we may agonize over in our own wisdom about, God, should I marry that person or should I not? Should I marry him or should I not? And so you kind of weigh this out, and you know, he loves me, he loves me not. He loves me, he loves me not. You know, and okay, you know, heads or tails, you know, heads I marry or tails I don't, you know, and you're leaving it up to chance. And if you don't believe that affects everybody around you, think about your own marriage and your own relationships. Whenever we are in the wisdom of God and we're letting him direct us and we're trusting in the Lord with all of our heart and leaning not into our own understanding, but in all of our ways acknowledging him, then he will direct our paths. Now what we want is God to tell us what the future is. Now God, if I make this decision today, now what's it going to be in the future for me? What's going to be my benefit? What's going to be my reward for this? And God says, trust me. Trust me. And so one of the things in which we must do is look back to some of the questions in which Jesus has already asked us and that we even look at today that we've seen in these sermons, and that is the first one that I preached to you a few weeks ago. Who do you say that I am? Jesus asked his disciples. And whenever we answer that question and we make the decision in our heart that Jesus is the Son of God and that he is the Savior of the world and that he is going to be my King and that I give myself to him, and you come into the realization of that, then you are beginning to grow in wisdom of whenever you can say, who is Jesus to you? Then we saw that the road that Jesus had to take going towards Calvary. And what road will you take? Life is filled with many paths. You know, and the problem of it, as we've already examined, is that broad is the way to destruction, but narrow is the way of godly way. So you know, which way will we choose? The way of the world and the broad way to destruction that leads to hell, or we're going to choose the path that Jesus says, I am the way, the truth, and the life, and no one comes to the Father except through me, that narrow path of Jesus. But then we also think about last week, real praying, R-E-A-L, real praying. And that is, will we pray? Will we seek the Father? Will we grow closer to him? Or will we fall asleep and become apathetic and lackadaisical about our spiritual growth and our spiritual life and our walk with Jesus? And then today, we see these decisions that every single person in which we've read about in these texts of scriptures, from Jesus to Pilate to the soldiers to Pilate's wife to the religious leaders to the crowds that were out there, every single one of them had a decision to make on that day. And we're going to examine it. And before we ever put ourselves into the text and imagining us there, I would always remind you, do not always make yourself out to be the hero. Do not say in your own heart and be deceived by Satan, I would never do that. I promise you this, we probably would have been in the crowd that was hollering, crucify him. And so there's where we will stand and we will look at these decisions that will be made, because there's three things that are going to affect your decisions: your past, your present, and your future. What do you base your decisions on? Some people are purely just stuck in the past. They cannot forgive the past. They cannot forget the past. They cannot overcome the past. And let me tell you, brothers and sisters, we all have a past. Now, some of you, your past is filled with glory and happiness. You were raised in a home with godly parents, and you came to know Christ at a very early age. And maybe your life was spared a lot of the sin and the muck and the mud and the shame and the darkness and the filth and other things that come along with the association of this world. But you listen to testimonies of others, and you think, wow, my testimony isn't that great. Yes, it is. Your testimony is about how good God is to you, not how bad you've been. And so as we look about how that good that God has been to us, you need to praise God that maybe you did not go through some of those things. But I can promise you this, no matter how good your life has been, it's filled with stuff. It's called sin. You want me to tell you how I know that? The Bible plainly states it. For we've all sinned and fallen short of the glory of God. So hello, sinners. Thank you. But hello, saints. Some of you are confused about whether or not if you're a sinner or a saint. We are all sinners. But if you've come to know Jesus as being your Savior and he's forgiven your past and you have given your life over to him, then now you're a saint. Not by the worldly definition, but by the biblical definition. And so whenever we look about making decisions, let us make decisions based on our sainthood, not our sinful ways. As we look into these things about looking at our past, I want to assure you that as we look about Jesus, we look at his past, he always did what the Father told him to do. He was always on the Father's agenda. You go back to his life as a boy. The last thing we have recorded about his childhood is that he grew in favor with and in stature with man and with God. We move on into his life a little bit further, and what we see Jesus in the temple with his parents. Don't tell me it's not important to take your children to church. If Mary and Joseph saw the need to take Jesus to church, then parents, there's a need for you to have your children in church. Amen? I get sick of hearing people talk about, I can be saved, I can be a Christian, I don't need to go to church. Immediately my first thoughts is, if you're saved, you'd want to be in church. And especially you'll want to be bringing up those little ones. And you'll want to bring up your children in the ways of the Lord. And you remember that when Jesus was in the temple, you remember that it was a 3 days journey back home, and Mary and Joseph accidentally forgot Jesus in the temple. You know, and Mary and Joseph had left because Mary thought it was with Joseph, and Joseph thought it was with Mary, and they thought that maybe he was with some of the other family that was in the caravan. You know, and there was that moment where Mary probably looked at Joseph and said, where's Jesus? And he said, I thought it was with you. No, I thought it was with you. And Mary saying, Jesus! And turning around and going back. And where do they find him? In the temple. As a young boy, teaching the elders in the temple. And whenever mama got a hold of him, you know, this is probably the closest that Jesus ever got to being spanked. But mama grabbed a hold and realized, I got a hold of God here. He ain't never given me no trouble before. What were you doing? And he looked at his mama in the eye and said, did you not know I must be about my Father's business? There was never a time in Jesus' life whenever he was not following what the Father was having him to do. Oh, how I wish we could say that about us, but we're all sinners. We have fallen short of the glory of God, and we've moved away from where we need to be with him. And we've made our own decisions, and we've not been on God's agenda. But where are you today? We see that sometimes our decisions, we need to look at about how that it's going to press into our future. You see, if Jesus would have made the decision in the garden, Father, let this cup pass from me. But nevertheless, thy will be done. If his prayer would have been, Father, I don't want this cup, and I'm not going to do this cup. And if he would have walked away from the assignment that God had given to his only begotten son, then the future would have affected him, but we all would have been condemned to hell today. So decisions in which we must make are made in the present. But a lot of times they're based off the past, and they will affect the future. Let's talk about Pilate just for a moment. Pilate. There's only about 4 hours of history actually recorded in the Bible of Pilate's life, but yet in external studies about Pilate, we learn quite a bit about this man. For instance, even in the Apostles' Creed, which we're Baptist and we're not creedal people, but yet we're biblical people. You've ever heard the phrase before, and he suffered under Pontius Pilate? You know, those words have meaning to them that help us to understand how that Jesus suffered under Pontius Pilate and the decisions in which he made. Let's look a little bit about Pilate's past, and that is, first off, Pilate did not have a wealthy upbringing. At best, he came from a middle-class family. And he served in the Roman army. And he served in an area of the world in which we would know today as being more of Germany. And while he was in a long stay in Rome, he caught the affection and the attention of a Roman girl that was of very high society. You know, if you were to play the game, what doesn't belong? Pilate did not belong with this girl named Claudia. Her name was Claudia Pacola, and she was actually the illegitimate daughter of her mother, who was named Claudia, who was the third wife of the emperor Tiberius and
that made her the granddaughter of, here's a name for you, Caesar Augustus. Now, do you remember the name Caesar Augustus? You see, Caesar Augustus is the one that declared there should be a census taken that brought Mary and Joseph to Bethlehem. Remember that? And so now we're seeing, wait a moment, you mean to tell me this Pontius Pilate was actually kin by marriage to Caesar Augustus, who was not a good man to begin with? You're absolutely right, but stay with me. Because of his connection with the man at the top, Pilate was given a position that would have never been given to him any other way. You see, in AD 26, on the recommendation of Tiberius, the right-hand man, Pilate was appointed governor of Judah. Now you see, whenever Caesar Augustus was trying to figure out, who am I going to put down there as governor, down there around those bunch of Jews down there that are really a thorn in my flesh, they're always just trouble to me, who can I put down there? And out of all the unlikely candidates, Pilate came to the top at the recommendation of Caesar Augustus' right-hand man, Tiberius. Now, are y'all with me on this? Don't glaze over on me, donuts. Stay with me on this. This is going to go somewhere or another. You see, it was in Luke chapter 3, verse 1, that tells us that Pilate was governor when John the Baptist began his ministry. And like many who get their jobs because of not what they know, but because of who they know or who they're kin to, let me just kind of give you a hypothetical situation, okay, to kind of help you to understand this and put you into modern time. Let's say that you have a daddy that is a very, very powerful, very well-known world figure. And so you want to get rich, but you don't have any qualifications to really be able to get that away on your own, so you ride in on the dovetail of the big guy. And so daddy gets you appointed to boards in foreign countries where you have no experience in what you're doing, but all of a sudden you're raking in millions of dollars. I don't need to call no names. Y'all are shaking your head. You know what I'm talking about. Okay, now, what we got to look at, that is the big fancy word is nepotism. And so you've heard that in the news lately, nepotism. Nepotism is whenever you're riding in on somebody else's favor to get where you are in life. Now, there's good things that can come from that, and there's bad things that can come from that. I tell you right here, the only reason that I'm here today as being your pastor is because the influence of some people that I had in my life. I'm like the turtle you find on a fence post. If you ever find a turtle sitting up on top of a fence post, you can bet your bottom dollar he didn't get there on his own. But there's also bad whenever granddaddy Caesar, sees little granddaughter and he really wants to bless her and make her rich, and so he appoints this grandson-in-law, Pilate, to go be governor in this region of people that he really does not like. And so Pilate comes in there. And so he was uneducated, he was tactless, he was stubborn. He thought he knew it all. He thought that because he had authority, that meant he could enforce his will rather than exercise responsibility and also have compassion and concern for anybody else other than himself. But then whenever life got tough and the people were demanding that something take place, not this, this was not the first one. It was that in Jerusalem, water, the source of water was always an issue. They never had enough water. And so they complained to the government about, we need more water, we need more water, we need more water. And so it was Pilate who actually had the aqueducts designed and built to channel to bring the water into the city. Now you say, well, that's great. And he thought that since he was doing this for the benefit of the Jews, I'll also use their money. So Pilate instructed his tax collectors, Roman soldiers,
to not only collect a higher level of tax from the Jews, but to then go into the temple and to demand and take at arm, force, the temple tax so that he could build the aqueducts. Now, understand this right here. It was not just about the money. It was not just about the water. It was about his prestige. Look at me. Look at what I'm doing for you off the backs of others, especially the poor. Y'all with me on this? It gets worse. Whenever the Jews and some of the sympathizers with the Jews knew what Pilate was doing and then leveling these taxes against them and also going into the temple and pretty much robbing the place, they began to protest. And they took to the streets. It was not a riot protest. They were not burning buildings or flipping over donkey carts or, you know, anything along those lines. They were just letting their presence be known in the streets. But Pilate did not like it, primarily because they were Jews and there was a dislike from the Romans towards the Jews. So what did Pilate do? Pilate then instructed his soldiers to take their uniforms off, put on regular clothes, and go and mingle among the crowd, and to embed themselves deep into the rioters that are out in the street. And then upon his signal, they were then to bring out clubs, swords, and spears and to begin to execute the protesters in the street right where they were. Oh, it gets worse. By the way, this is Luke 13. And it gets worse because then Pilate then took the blood of the people that were slain in the street and mixed it with the blood of the sacrifices of the Jews at the temple. So I want to make sure that you understand the past of this man, because you read these scriptures and you think, oh, he had compassion on Jesus. He really did not want to do it. No, this was a very hardened man who really did not care about nobody else but himself. And so also Pilate was a man that could not take responsibility for his own actions. He was one of those that always wanted to be in charge, but he never wanted to make the decision. So that way, if the wrong decision was made or if an unfavorable decision was made, then he could blame it on somebody else. But if the right decision was made, then he'd be the first one at the press conference saying, look at what I did. Look at how good I have been to you. And if it's somebody else's fault, well, it was the other side of the aisle that did it. Some things just ain't never changed, have they? What do we see here? We see this man who could not make a decision, and that's why he was giving it up to the people. And I want to share something with you. As a nation and as a church, thank God we live in a democracy. But we are a democratic republic. We're here. We always take the lesson that the majority does not always rule, because the majority does not always make the best decision. I've been in situations in my life and in my ministry where the majority wanted to do one thing, and the minority stood on the word of God and on principles and said no. And sometimes there's a price to pay for it here on earth. And you may lose friends over it. And sometimes they'll say, well, it's what the majority wanted. The majority of the people wanted Jesus crucified also. Just always remember that. So just because the majority of Americans want to vote something that God has called sinful into law does not ever make it right. Just because the majority of the legislators say abortion ought to be on demand anytime, anywhere, any place for any woman, and then the government ought to pay for it, does not make it right in the eyes of God. Let me tell you, I'd rather stand with the minority but be on God's side than the majority and win all the world favor. Because see, the past, and then the present, and then the future. Because see, I think that whenever we look about Jesus and we look at his past, he was always on the Father's agenda. We look at his present standing before Pilate and he had decisions to make. And one of the lessons that I learned from this was that whenever he was being accused, he kept his mouth shut. He remained silent. And you know what? Jesus had to. You know why? Because in Isaiah 53, it was prophesied that just as a sheep is silent before its slaughter, so will Jesus be. And he was silent before the sheep was silent before his shearer. So was Jesus before Pilate. It was fulfilling the prophecy. And in John 13, we read where he is also the Lamb of God. And so Jesus had to be just silent. Let me tell you, there are times whenever it's better to be quiet than to open your mouth and say something that you'll regret. But there's also a time whenever you need to speak up and you regret for being silent whenever you could have spoken up. Especially whenever God was telling you to speak something to someone on his behalf. For you see, we are his mouth. But Jesus knew he was standing before an evil man that was not going to change his heart, that Jesus could not win in a proper trial, and so he just remained silent. Well, I tell you what, as I'm thinking about this, I'm remembering a time when I was brought on a trial one time, not a court of law, but brought into a room full of men to put me on trial. And right before I went in there, I was praying, and this verse of Scripture came to my mind. And I remained silent, and it aggravated them because I wouldn't argue with them. I would not defend myself. I would not get mad. I just remained silent and just took a lot of notes. Sometimes that's the best thing to do, folks. It's just remain silent. But sometimes it's right to speak. But make sure that when you speak from God's Holy Spirit leading you. I wish I could obey that wisdom in my own life a little more often. But I'll tell you this, though. We've seen what happened with Pilate. We saw what happened with Jesus based on the decisions. But we also see the Roman soldiers. They were doing what they were told to do because this was part of their past. We see what they were doing in the present whenever they began to beat him and ridicule him and mock him and put the crown of thorns on him. But in the future, there was one that was standing at the foot of the cross whenever he looked up and he saw Jesus. He said, "Truly, this man is righteous and has done no wrong." We also see the decisions of those that were there in the crowd that day. I want to remind you that those who were crying out, crucify him, had a past with Jesus on the trail coming in as they were out there with their coats and palm branches and singing his songs, "Hosanna, Hosanna, blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord." For less than a week before, they were singing his praises, and now at the end of the week, they're screaming, "Crucify him." So don't forget your past. But their present was being influenced. And unfortunately, they were being influenced not so much by Caesar or by Pilate or by the Roman soldiers as much as what they were being wrongly influenced by the religious leaders of the day. The Scripture plainly tells us that they were the ones that were working the crowd and saying, "Have this man crucified. Tell him you don't want Jesus. Tell him you want Barabbas." It was they who were in the present swaying them. So people, be careful who you listen to. And then look at how it affected the future. Some of them slipped off into eternity and went to hell, and others came to the saving knowledge and had their sins washed away through the blood of Jesus at the foot of the cross. There's another person in this story, and that is Pilate's wife. she had a dream. And it was a nightmare. The scriptures does not tell us what the dream was. And so through conjecture, I will interject just a few thoughts to you. That it was so bad that the dream that she had about him, it woke her up. She could not sleep. And she even sent a message to her husband saying, "Don't have anything to do with this man." Could have the dream been that God showed her a glimpse of what Jesus was going to look like hanging on the cross? I had a friend of mine who came from a Catholic background ask, "Well, why do we as Baptists not have a crucifix hanging in our church?" I said, "Because Jesus ain't on the cross no more. We look at an empty cross." But in her dream, she saw Jesus. And while even the controversy around the Passion of the Passion of Christ movie, it came to probably the closest of any man-made description of what Jesus may have looked like through the beatings and through the crucifixion of what he may have looked like. But in a vision, in a dream, God may have showed her what Jesus was going to look like. And she was like, "No man should ever have to endure something like that." For see, Jesus' crucifixion was not just like a crucifixion that they had seen before. His was so much worse. Or did she in her dream perhaps see her husband being guilty of the sin of being before Jesus and denying Jesus and seeing her husband burn in hell? I don't know. But whatever it was, her decision was try to make an impact and an influence upon her husband. Oh, thank God for godly women. Thank God for women who have come along beside their husbands and have prayed for them and helped steer them into godly things. And whenever the husband won't be the spiritual leader of the home, that they assume the role to introduce God into the family and into the home and to want to be a part of spiritual things like being in church and praying and being in the Word of God. Thank you, godly ladies, for your influence, which you have made upon so many men. But here in this crowd, we see ourselves. Our past would tell us that we would probably be among those that had forgotten all the good that Jesus did and would be hollering, "Crucify." We see that today in our own lives, that whenever everything is rocking along and everything is going good and life is just wonderful and everything, you know, we're like, "Praise Jesus." But then whenever things get down into the valley, it's called life, and things start getting hard and decisions start having to be made that are tough ones and you don't want to make them everything, then where's God? You know what? And if he's going to put me through this, I'm going to show him something. I ain't going to have nothing to do with him. And you're gone. Usually it's a sign of whenever you stop wanting to be with other Christians, whenever you want to stop being a part of a fellowship and in a church, and whenever you no longer want to pray and talk to God and even cry out to God, and even sometimes whenever life is so hard and you don't even know what to say, the Holy Spirit, even through your own mumblings, can make sense to God. But you read his word. And sometimes it's very uncomfortable, and we don't like it because it points out a mirror to us, and we look at ourselves, and we don't like what we see, so we close it up, and we walk away from it saying, "I'm okay, I'm okay." And you start comparing yourself to other people to make yourself feel better. And so we forget about God, and pretty much whenever we forget about doing godly things God's way, then what we're really screaming is crucify. Where are you today in this present, right now? Where are you? Will you find yourself at the foot of the cross, where the ground is level and the blood is plentiful and all the sins can be washed away? Will you make a decision today to follow him? Your future depends on it. Your future will either be spent either in eternity hell or eternity heaven. Go to hell, do absolutely nothing to get there. But to go to heaven, you have to accept Jesus as being your Savior. And if you've not done so today, then we invite you to come and to know Him as being your Savior. And brothers and sisters, the decisions that you make today concerning Jesus will have an effect not only on you, but on those that are around you. Those you love the most, your family, your friends, your co-workers, your fellow church members. And see the future of where what you do today in planting a seed might one day grow to be a mighty oak for somebody else to enjoy. Will you make the decision today, the right decision? Follow Jesus. As Michael comes and leads us in this song of invitation, I'll be here at the front. The altar's open, and I'll be glad to pray with you, to talk with you. There's others that will pray with you as well. Let's stand together as we sing this song.
I have decided to follow Jesus. I have decided to follow Jesus. I have decided to follow Jesus. No turning back, no turning back. The world behind me, the cross before me, the world behind me, the cross before me, the world behind me, the cross before me, no turning back, no turning back.
Hey, thank you so much for being here today. Man, the messages God's put on my heart and these coming up, I want to share just real quick with you. The series of sermons I'm getting ready to preach, I was first introduced to those messages back in the early 90s when I was first going to the ministry. And a pastor by the name of Dr. Richard Jackson preached this series of messages that probably gave me the greatest inspiration for these messages, probably had one of the greatest impacts upon my life. And also my ministry and my preaching. He was the pastor at North Phoenix Baptist Church, where he had celebrated over 10,000 baptisms. And he is now retired. He's 85 years old. He lives in Texas. And just a few nights ago, I had the privilege of being able to talk with him on the telephone. I mean, to me, you know, you got to understand. I mean, it'd be like some of y'all talking to Dabo, you know. But what a blessing it was. And I told him about the series, and I told him what I want to do, and I said, do you still have any of your old notes? And he said, Daniel, I'll mail them to you. And he said, and brother, he says, if you gain anything from it, you put it in your gun and you shoot it. He said, you just go with it. And so I really want to invite you to be back for these next series and invite somebody to come with you. I promise you, whenever you visit the foot of the cross, like what we're going to be doing, it's going to change you. I promise you. Also, don't forget about our soup drive we got going on right now. Bring your cans of soup. Buggy's in the vestibule in the Welcome Center. Let's go out of here with a benediction on our hearts and our minds today. The grace of the Lord Jesus Christ and the love of God and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with you all. And all of God's people said, amen.